Everyone, this is Abdu Alkishe, a postdoctoral at Department of Fish and Wildlife Conservation, Virginia Tech. Today I'm going to talk about model interpretation. So our ecological needs models involves in understanding the output from running our models. So in this figure, you can see we have input data that's in occurrence data and environmental variables for example, current time, and another one for a future time. And then we run those input data using model algorithm. And after that, we got the output as a models. So here I'm going to talk about a few or some key aspects when we are going to interpreting our ecological niche models. So the first one is the model output, what kind of output we will have, and environmental variables, which the most contributed variables, and model performance. And that in the end, we will talk a little bit about uncertainty and delimitation of our ecological niche modeling. The model output here is typically produced maps or spatial predictions that represent the potential suitable habitat or the probability of occurrence for a species across a geographic area. So these predictions are often presented as continuous surface, as you see here in the figure. In the upper maps, you see continuous output from low, that means the dark blue means not suitable or very low prediction, and dark brown, which is the high suitability. And also we have another option to create a binary presence absence map, which is in the bottom maps. Well, here we say, for example, we put a threshold as 5% of our occurrence points maybe have errors or mistakes. So we decide to have just two categories, zero as not suitable and one as a suitable for a species. For environmental variables, ENMs, or in ecological niche models, rely on environmental variables to model the ecological niche of species, and it's important to examine which variables have the strongest influence on the model and understand their ecological relevance. So with identifying the key environmental factors that define the species niche can provide insights into its habitat performance and requirements. As in this case, or in this example, this paper examined a species and two genetic population. And here in the left, the first one, they found the most contributed variable is BIO12, which is the mean annual rainfall for the species. And for the genetic population one, they found the soil texture fraction clay is the most contributed variable. And for the genetic population two, they found the BIO14, which is the rainfall driest month. So it's important to see if you use this kind of variables, not using principal component analysis. So you have to understand your species and see if this is making sense to your species. Model performance, this is a most important part. So here, as an example, this bat species, the records are distributed in eastern and western sub-Saharan countries. And as you see in the red buffers, this is the calibration area. And what I want to point it out here, once you run the models and get results, they are response curves. And here we are, I used principal component analysis, and we have 1, 2, 3, and you see the behavior of the curves for the principal component 1 and 3. This is the normal curves. This is like probability of suitability, and this is the correct shape for the response curve. For the principal component 2, it's behaving in weird shape, and this is like making a concern about using principal component 2 in this model. And we have here the line with calibration area. So those lines saying this is the area of calibration area, beyond that it's the other areas, or we when we project our models. So what I'm going to point it out here about three different models, which is extrapolation and clamping, and no extrapolation. So in this example with extrapolation, that we allow our models to go beyond this line, which is the calibration area, calibration models. So the model extrapolation, we allow the model to go beyond our calibration models, and it's sometimes behaving down, or sometimes in this case behaving up. So in this extrapolation area, we have more predictions in areas that we are not sure about it. The other one is extrapolation and clamping. In this one, or in this type of models, we allow extrapolation, but we keep it as a straight, going straight. In this example, like in this area. So the behaving is different from extrapolation. The third type is when we don't allow extrapolation. So we tell the model to cut the prediction. And as you see here, as a result, we don't have more extrapolation area. So those are the three different models. And after that, we have to take a look out about our models to see where are the uncertainty in our models. So what's that uncertainty? How we calculate uncertainty? So the areas of strict extrapolation, those areas are coming because we project our models to another geographic area, or for another time in future or in past. So we have to compare our models using analysis called mobility-oriented party metrics. And this is like doing a comparison between environmental conditions from the calibration area and between the area of projection, whether we use time or geographic space. So this method can evaluate the level of similarity between the calibration and the projection area, and identify or give us an idea about the areas with the strict extrapolation. For example, here in this work, as you see, the area with the under the black circle on the left, we have a suitable area, and when we applied the extrapolation analysis, we found that we have to be cautious about interpreting this area as suitable, since we have a high strict extrapolation in that area. So this is a simple example how to identify non-analog or non-similar areas after projecting our models in future or in geographic space. Limitations. So we have like the first point is non-equilibrium distributions, such that a species doesn't occupy the full extent of its climatically suitable area, owing to dispersal limitations or biotic interactions. The effect of this situation is that the models can be mistuned and often will be overly restrict in their predictions of distributional potential. And also we have a biases in sampling among the input occurrence data, and this is because the data are concentrated in some regions more than other regions, and that may be cause bias and model results. And in the third point is when we have occurrence data and showing considerable variation in their spatial resolution, which again can cause difficulties in model outputs. So the take-home exam is to explain your ecological niche models, you require careful concentration of the model output, and you have to look at your algorithm or results performance, and you have to take a look at environmental variables and their ecological relevance. And it's also important to understand the context of the study, in which means you have to understand your species, the physiology, and understand what kind of variables are crucial for this species. Thank you so much for listening, and hope everything was clear. Thank you.